goodness.
Oh, my, oh, my.
Holy cow, is it a muddled wild card race? Just when we thought we would finally get some clarity Monday night, we get none.
This team just doesn't quit.
Charlie Lindgren has whitewashed the Bruins for a second time this season.
Yes, the Flyers still have a very slim chance. It's going to be madness.
It doesn't get any better than this.
It's going to come down to game 82.
Yep, it all comes down to this. Hey, everyone, and welcome to On the Fly. I'm Erica Wachter. Mike Kelly will join us in just a bit to break down all of Tuesday's action. So final games of the year, and that final playoff spot in the Eastern Conference is still a four-team race with the Penguins, Flyers, Red Wings, and Capitals all vying for a trip to the postseason. Now, Sidney Crosby's Penguins, they were watching Tuesday's action, rooting for both the Caps and Red Wings to lose in order to keep their hopes alive. The Flyers had to win against the Caps to stay in the hunt, while Washington was the only team that controlled their own fate. The Caps just need to win against Philly, and they are in. But if the Flyers could pull off a win over the Caps, the Wings could punch their ticket with a victory over the Habs. So we are talking high drama in both Philly and Montreal. Let's get right to the highlights.
Eric Berlach, Kelly Sutherland with the referee, Scott Cherry, Steve Barton on the line, an early post for Washington.
TJ trying to go short side, definitely beats their goaltender cleanly.
He does get it back to Tyson. He'll turn, fire, and a glove save. Berlindgren, his first save of the game, a tester from Forsstrom.
For one last time this season, Montreal has the spotlight for a game with huge playoff implications.
Here's Larkin, in for Raymond, right on a goal, and a save made, a piece of that by Caden Primo.
Oh, I can't believe that Lucas Raymond, he just pounded the puck, that he missed that. He's been making everything that he puts on the net lately.
You can see to Joel Farabee.
Farabee will fire, a save. It bounces high, and a whistle stops play. A whistle stops play. The referee lost sight of the puck. Oh. It was in the air, lands near the net, put in, but the referee, I believe it was Kelly Sutherland, lost sight and blew it dead early.
You gotta be kidding me.
He didn't have it.
The officials are getting together here.
The whistle came. Charlie, the benefit of a great break.
When it was up in the air and the official lost sight of the puck.
I don't think there's any recourse in this play.
After video review, it's determined the play is dead. The puck hits the Philadelphia player. It is not the continuous shot. Therefore, no goal.
They got it right on the review. Kelly Sutherland got it wrong, obviously, by blowing the whistle.
It's Gallagher. In across. What time drive score? Alex Newhook. New career high. Goal 15. And it's 1-0 Montreal.
It's just a feathered pass by Brendan Gallagher. James Reimer's not able to get across. And a really nice look by Logan Mayhew right onto the tape of Brendan Gallagher. It's 1-0 Canadiens.
Veteran Savard gave it up. Larkin on a steal, drop back to Sider. Score! Sider with a blast. Going to the net was Raymond. And it's a 1-1 tie with 91 seconds to go in the first.
And right there, I think Alec DeBrincat may have got a piece of this. And the direction change gave Primo no chance. Regardless, it's tied.
Stepping up and taking away their guy with the puck, preventing him from creating anything.
Deflection, score! It hit Ovechkin in front, and Washington grabs the lead.
Exactly what they need, isolation of Ovi, and there it is off his stick and bottom hand. Ovechkin on the board here in Philadelphia.
Given away here to Brinkett. Boy, the Red Wings rattled the iron locks last night against Montreal.
As Armia brings it in, Drago shoots. Oh, what a play, score! Stays red hot, 16 on the year, and Montreal's got the lead back.
Good move in tight. Newhook gets in, hit the goal post, rebound, and Reimer down, he's got it.
That is one of the funniest, strangest hit of a goal post you're ever going to see in a hockey game.
What a move, Suzuki. Suzuki stick counting. Sokolovsky, what a stop! Rebound, score! Cole Caulfield! 28 goals on the season for Cole Caulfield, and Montreal
Detroit's playoffs hopes dwindling as the game goes on.
Strong got it back, Gostisbehere on a penalty.
craziness. We're going to have a repeat of last night.
Couturier back to Zamula. Zamula looking, waiting, wrist, and deflection, score! Joel Farabee cutting across, so is Couturier. It deflects in, the Flyers have tied it at one. Here in the second period,
Zamula heads up, finds a way to get this puck through, and Johnson's stick in front with the redirect. The body positioning on Trevor Riemsdyk, no chance for Lindgren. That is a perfect tip by Johnson, and the Flyers have tied this thing up.
Here's Matheson for Suzuki.
Across the floor.
Carlson for Oshie, undercut by Paley, quick shot, deflection, save, rebound, oh, what a save by Lindgren on Konechny.
Magnificent Lindgren there, he robbed Konechny.
It's Couturier, slot pass, paddle aside, follow-up chance, Forster, great effort there by Dylan Strome.
A good chance for Forster to put that baby home, to the rescue is Dylan Strome.
When the games mean this much, big league hockey players turn into street hockey players.
Chance side of the goal for Zarnik, he was blocked out, too many red jerseys in front of him. Strome's got it, sharp at the goal.
Dances his way in, Paling the shot, save, rebound, all the way out, Johnson shot, blocked.
Real good block once again by the Caps in front of the net. Look at how quickly the big fella gets out and slides and makes a great block.
Look out here, Suzuki's in the clear. Nick Suzuki, in on the big stop by Robert.
Now at the draw, the shot by Tippett and the save by Lindgren. Tippett, a great job here.
Looked like a little rip check by Tippett there. Sort of a sneak attack as that puck came into the center of the circle.
Lee Hudson shuffling around the blue line. Wrist shot, tip, score! Juraj Slafkovský! Lee Hudson, first point at the Bell Center. Juraj Slafkovský, first 20-goal season. And the Montreal Canadiens have a 4-3 lead.
No face-off bigger than the one that's upcoming. Dylan Larkin on the draw against Evans. Scramble, face-off, comes back, quick shot.
Scores!
Scores!
David Perron! It's a tie game! David Perron has tied it up! Wow!
You believe this ridiculous comeback that's been going on?
Unbelievable!
Oh, John Carlson feeds. Barabari drives, head save, rebound. At the doorstep, it's covered. Airson has it long enough for the whistle.
And at this juncture, you just got a whack and hack in front of the net. Huge play in front by Nick Dell.
It's a 1-1 game. Philadelphia has to win in regulation.
I'm sure they're already talking about that and have a plan in place for what time they'll be pulling Airson.
Airson is gone. Flyers gambling in this tie game. They have to beat Washington in regulation. Through center, it's Oshie. Oshie working wide. Fires, he scores! Washington has the one-goal lead to protect with 3 minutes to go. Center, 3 seconds left. Washington will be the number 8 in the East. And the Rangers await.
And hugs all around on the coaches, on the bench, and around Charlie Lindgren. The Caps are going to the playoffs. A clinch of playoff berth for the 15th time in the last 17 seasons.
So the Red Wings here, if they can get a victory, it'll be just for bragging rights. Unfortunately, it'll be a 8th consecutive season out of the playoffs for Detroit as Washington has defeated Philadelphia on an empty net goal. Scores! And the Red Wings win it. And they did their part. Unfortunately, the Washington Capitals spoiled things.
We've been building something special here for the whole season, and it started with a change of systems, change of personnel, losing our number one and number two center eventually, guys just constantly stepped up to the plate and paid the price to get the job done. So ton of character in that room, and I'm super proud to be one of their brothers.
I'm not gonna go chapter verse with you guys right now, right after the game, so a lot of the questions you should just probably wait in the next couple of days. I'm proud of the team. They fought to the end. This was a high-stakes game, and started off very tentative. But then I thought we got on the attack and give them credit. They defended well. They defended a lot. And we just couldn't find our way. I get info on the Detroit game right after they scored their empty netter. I think it happened pretty close together. But I was pulling them, and that was the right time to pull them. Didn't know anything was going on with Detroit at that time, but immediately after that, our video guys told us that Detroit just went to overtime.
Gutted for the guys. The battle they showed all year, the battle they showed down the stretch, and we took 7 of our last 8 points. The way we've done it, this group won 14 games when trailing in the third. Just, I feel awful for the guys because this group battled, they overachieved, they just kept fighting all year long. Not ideal. This stings, this hurts. It's a proud organization. We're taking steps to get this back where this organization belongs.
All right, so the wild card race has officially finished. The Capitals punching their ticket to the postseason as they've got 91 points. That's how they finished the year. The Penguins, of course, have one more game to go. That's against the Islanders tomorrow, but that will no longer matter as they will finish behind the Red Wings regardless of what happens. So much drama down the stretch here to close out this season, and now we officially got our playoff field set. We welcome in Mike Kelly now to break it all down. That highlight was so much fun. I think it really encapsulated the night overall, but again, it is the Caps who punch their ticket. So how did Washington get it done tonight?
You know what? You got to give this team a lot of credit. And the defensive effort they put in the last couple games, especially a game ago, but even in this one, it was pretty good. Charlie Lindgren goes back-to-back games and is outstanding for the Capitals. But, you know, in the Boston game, he didn't have to be that great. That Washington played one of its best defensive games of the season. And we heard John Tortorella talk about how Washington jammed them up a lot of times in this game. And Lindgren made some unbelievable saves. So those two things over the last couple of days is really what stood out to me. And Charlie Lindgren, you know, he might not get a single Hart Trophy vote. Maybe he shouldn't. But by the definition of the award, a guy most valuable to his team, the Capitals aren't having a sniff at the postseason without this guy. He comes in kind of out of nowhere, at least for people that don't follow the Capitals, and saved their season. He was unbelievable at the right time for the Washington Capitals. And it's not surprising to see him go back-to-back and get it done in these last two games.
It's so true. MVP of the season by far for the Washington Capitals, and just a monster part of their stretch, because you look at this Capitals team and on paper, you're not thinking that they are playoff bound. It is an unsightly goal differential. Have we seen anything like this before? I mean, it's pretty unreal, these numbers.
It is. Well, look, I mean, there was a time when 16 out of 21 teams made the playoffs and you had a minus 77 Winnipeg Jets make the playoffs. Those days are long gone. Now half the teams get in. But I think to answer your question, we haven't seen anything like this in the salary cap era. And that's coming up on 20 years. Capitals at minus 37. I mean, Florida wasn't even close when they won the old Southeast Gong Show division and had a minus 24. This year's New York Islanders are on this board. None of these teams won their first round playoff series, by the way. And it won't be a shocker if that ends up holding true as well. But, you know, the thing about the Capitals is games decided by 4 goals, 5 goals, all that. Yeah, they lost a lot of them, and that really inflated that goal differential. They did pretty well in close games. So, again, you give hats off to Charlie Lindgren. And if you want to say that maybe they found a way to do that or they had some sort of recipe, well, maybe they did. Maybe things kind of fell their way a lot. And whatever, who cares? At the end of the day, 8 teams are in the East. Washington's one of them. They play a best of 7 just like everybody else. And if they get 4 wins, they move on. So we'll see what the second season brings for the Caps.
Yeah, that's exactly it. It's a new season. So even though those numbers are pretty crazy, that is all behind them now. They're turning their attention to the postseason. And we'll just look back at the regular season for the Red Wings, though, because they fall just short of the playoffs. But we got to give them a little love. What an effort, especially these last two nights, how exciting they made this finish here.
It's incredible. Imagine being a Detroit Red Wings fan. Oh, you're probably in a full sweat in your couch, just like, oh my goodness, this team. Hats off. I don't have one on my head right now, but Detroit Red Wings. Like Derek Lalonde talked about the guts of this team to come back in these games. And 2 nights in a row, you get down by multiple goals and you pull the goalie late and you tie it. and you win it in extra time. I mean, they did everything they could in these last two games, and they fall just short. And I think the thing for the Red Wings is no one really expected them to make the playoffs. And yeah, they're kind of this up-and-coming team, and maybe they could make it close, you know, meaningful games in March, as everybody says. Well, mm-hmm. they played a lot of meaningful games in April. So there's a lot to be proud of, I think, if you're the Detroit Red Wings. But, you know, you rely too often on magic, and it often ends tragic. And that's what happened for Detroit. They have a lot of breakdowns defensively, and it's something that I'm sure they'll look at in the summer and try to clean up for next season.
Yeah, absolutely. Not enough magic to pull out of that hat, but just an incredible finish. And that is how the wild card officially finishes. But, you know, there were some more games that had some meaning here on this Tuesday. The top spot in the Atlantic Division was on the line in Boston. So let's see the highlights from the Bruins and the Senators.
Jack Edwards, voice of the Boston Bruins since 2005, announced earlier today his plans to retire at the end of the season. From high above the ice, his iconic voice became synonymous with countless moments in Bruins history. Jack's charisma, passion, and presence in the booth will absolutely be missed. Tonight, both Nesson and the Boston Bruins want to thank Jack for his service and wish him all the best as he transitions into retirement. Ladies and gentlemen, Jack Edwards!
There is ramifications with this game, you're right. So Boston Bruins are going to have their best effort here trying to close out the division.
Bruins with the puck in the Ottawa zone. Cycle deep, Pastrnak shoots, sharp angle. Forsberg was ready, but on his way down as the puck went up and just got enough.
Pasta will get caught and lost in space behind coverage.
Around the boards. Chance for Shane Pinto, and a brilliant leg save by Olmark. And Brady Tkachuk and Kevin Shattenkirk exchange blows, and Pinto steers Shattenkirk to the end board.
You're going to see a lot of that starting Saturday.
Thomas Chabot took a big hit from Peek in the first, and I've yet to see him in the second.
It looked like that stung him as he looked winded on the bench.
Bruins crowd trying to get Boston moving, but it's the Sens, it's Schmeichel! Scores! Schmeichel found a way to slip it through Omar. And if it counts, that's his first in the NHL.
It's in. I know the ref waved it off emphatically. That was Brandon Blandina, but the puck went across the line.
After reviewing the original call, Pauly Ice is overturned. There's a goal.
And he had to wait a bit longer, but it is the fist pump from Schmeichel, who gets his first NHL goal in the last game of the season.
Big smile on his face, and rightfully so.
Pinto tripped up by Coyle, looks back, won't get a call. Three sends the other way. Patterson stretches it out. Chychrun scores! Jacob Chychrun, first time playing all 82, and he capitalizes in the last game of the season. Forsberg just out of reach of Magna. Now goes to Larko. Chychrun blocks it. He takes that one in the low section, and Chychrun in some trouble will force the play to be stopped.
Well, that stung him immediately as he jumped right into the lane. This is a selfless play, too. Listen, you got 10 minutes left in your season, and he's still playing for keeps. That's pretty impressive.
Ottawa laying it all on the line tonight. They've lost Chabot for the first, and Chychrun to the room.
Pastrnak to Shattenkirk. Throws it on goal! Net. That is what Kevin Shattenkirk does so well.
McAvoy dangling his way in, finds DeBrus, some speed, side door! Anton Forsberg with the save of the year in the last game of the year. They're not empty. McAvoy had that one slip past him. Pastrnak gave it up. Zub shoots, scores! Artem Zub into the empty cage, shorthanded. That might do it for Ottawa.
I think we've had a lot of adversity during the season. There was a spell there in December. We weren't playing well. We came out of that after Christmas break, had a great stretch right till All-Star break, came out All-Star break, and again, had a little bit of a setback, faced some adversity, and I think we've really grown since then. Well, I was just glad to see our transition to offense and our ability to end plays and protect lines defensively, which led to a lot of offensive opportunities there in the last 27 minutes.
Anton Forsberg continues to play exceptionally well against the Boston Bruins. With the Senators win on Tuesday, Forsberg is now 4-0-1 in five career games against the Bees. He owns a 2.38 goals against average and a .932 save percentage in that span. So the Sens win opens the door for Florida to take the Atlantic Division title. They could beat the Leafs.
Thousands of Leaf fans have made the trip down. They didn't come down to see the Leafs play the right way, to check well. Austin Matthews potentially score 70 goals. 25 power plays in the season series. Only one goal scored by the Leafs. Slides away and moves that down to Riley. Dr. Marner with a shot, scored!
Power play goal for the Leafs. And they've got the early 1-0 lead already. The impact of Marner returning to the power play. Felt in the first 3.5 minutes.
Points in all six games since returning from missing 12 with a knee injury. Picked up by Gregor. Noah Gregor, long shot, scored! Noah Gregor sneaks it through, his first goal in 34 games, and the Leafs have a 2-0 lead.
You never know. It finds a way to get past Stolarz.
Noah Gregor's last goal was scored 4 months ago today.
Terrific road period. A terrific road team. Another try. Six-game absence. Welcome back. He scores his 34th, 28 seconds into the period to get the Panthers on the board. Well, there's the jolt they needed.
Montour
with a drive. Saved by Bawo. The rebound on the edge of the crease. Cleared by Doerr. Swept by Holmgren. Waffled up against the glass by Montour. But he was willing to pay the price to one-hand the puck out of the zone.
I was just going to say, that's a playoff play by Holmberg. He knows that Montour's going to flatten him.
Drops it back to Kachuk. Matthew Kachuk, great wide pass to Forsling. Shoot! The puck is scored!
Swept towards the net. Innocent looking it up from Forsling. And it found its way past goal. It looks like Sam Bennett got the tip, and we're tied.
Riley and Labushkin give up the blue line. It's an easy entry for Verhaeghe.
A 2-2 tie here in the second. In comes Markovic. Rebound scores. Sam Reinhart
adds to his total, number 56. And the Panthers, 10 seconds after getting the equalizer, have the lead.
10 seconds ago, it's 2-1 Toronto. It's now 3-2 Florida.
Swept by Barkov to the point. Montour with a blast.
Been an onslaught.
Three goals in 3 minutes and 10 seconds for Florida.
It was 2-0 Toronto after one.
Matthews standing in front. Riley finds him. Matthews in, has him down, puts it back in front. The puck stayed out. How did Austin Matthews miss? It was right there.
Matthews went backhand to forehand and tried to tuck it past Stolarz. He just got it into the blue paint that close to number 70. Marner on the move. Marner out in front, and the tip missed by as it got behind Stolarz. Hard to see how he missed it.
Just slides by a stick. He moved the stick too early. Could have been a tap in. Not quite yet.
Throw towards the net. Nylander. Oh, Nick Blocker save made by Stolarz. Close to Raiden. Gets it off to Reinhart towards the empty net. Score! 57 for Sam Reinhart. Will put an exclamation point. The Panthers not only win, but win their division in the process.
Not the night the Toronto Maple Leafs were hoping for. Not for Austin Matthews, not for the group.
Pretty good. I mean, that's the best we could ask for today. I really liked our second and third period. Fed off the crowd, got our energy going. So hopefully we can carry that over.
You guys are obviously in a different position than when you entered the playoffs last year. How does it feel different to you?
I think the last couple weeks are certainly different. You try and learn being in a different situation. Ultimately that gave us success. We felt playing our best hockey going into playoffs. We've been finding it, and certainly an effort like tonight, and the second half especially. That's a big way to finish.
Well, the playoff picture is set in the East, with the Capitals clinching the second wildcard spot on Tuesday. They will officially face the Rangers in the first round. The Bruins will take on the Leafs in the first round for the first time since 2019. And the Battle of Florida will take center stage as the Panthers win the Atlantic Division and will take on the Lightning. So Mike will have to wait, hopefully, just one more game to see Austin Matthews hit 70. But let's talk about the team that he was facing, and that is the Panthers. They follow up their trip to the Stanley Cup final by winning the Atlantic Division. And they seem pretty calm there, just talking post-game. They look built for the playoffs. What kind of run do you see them going on?
Yeah, I agree with you that they're built for the playoffs. I mean, they're a heavy team. They are a skilled team. They've got good goaltending. They check a lot of boxes. So I look at the second period. I mean, we heard Sam Reinhart talk about the second period. They obliterated the Maple Leafs in this period. Like, these statistics are unbelievable. That's where the game was essentially won for Florida. But that's what they can do to teams. That's what they can do to good teams. They can push you out of a game so fast. And, you know, think about Florida that's different than what they were that year. They won the President's Trophy and they got bounced early. They are a dump and chase team. They dump pucks in more than anyone else in the NHL, and they forecheck and they win battles. Of course, they've got skill. They've got speed with guys like Verhaeghe. Gus Forsling has had an unbelievable year. Alex Barkov, unbelievable year. They've got so many guys that are just built for that time of year, I think. And look, they're not going to have an easy go of it the way Tampa's going right now. That's going to be an incredible series, but I don't know how you don't like Florida as potentially being the team that does come out of the East.
Sure. Well, the Battle of Florida seems to never disappoint. Looking forward to that. And I think we may have heard about this matchup before. Another first-round meeting between the Bruins and the Leafs. What's most intriguing about this one?
Look, they've got a ton of history. These teams don't like each other. And we know it's been pretty one-sided for Boston in the playoffs. I think outside looking in anyways, you could make an argument that Toronto would have rathered Boston and Boston would have rathered Toronto.
Sure.
So maybe, you know what? Well, great. We got each other. Well, now what? Someone's going home in the first round. You look at the playoffs, the last, you know, somewhat recent history, it's all been Boston. Boston 4-0 in the season series this year. The thing about the Bruins, decided goaltending advantage. They've got some of the best goaltending in the league with Allmark, Swayman. If it'll be both, one of them doesn't matter. Their defensive game is not what it used to be. And when you consider who's gone from this team, you can understand why. They still have some pretty big game breakers, though. You look at the season series, and yeah, it was tilted. The one thing that stands out for me here is Boston effectively scored what it should have based on what it generated. Toronto didn't, because Boston's got great goaltending. And when you think about the Maple Leafs playoff failures in years past, including rounds against the Bruins, it more than anything else, it hasn't been defense. It's been they can't get goals when they need to get goals. And playoff hockey, you've got half a second less and a few feet less every time you've got the puck. And Maple Leafs have had a hard time adjusting to that in the past. Boston forechecks really well. It'll be a good series.
Yeah, we'll be, and I have to imagine that coming into it, both of these teams are especially motivated for. We don't have to wait long, just right around the corner. And you won't have to wait long for more action. We've got a lot more to go here on the fly, including out west. We know the eight teams that are in, but home ice and the seating, well, that is still on the line. Winnipeg, Vancouver, and Vegas all try to improve their positioning Tuesday. I'll show you all that next. Welcome back to On the Fly. The Jets could lock up home ice advantage in the first round with a win over Seattle.
The Jets are surging toward the playoffs. Currently the hottest team in the NHL, riding a six-game winning streak, and they get a little bit stronger tonight with the return of Nito Niederreiter, who sat out the last five games with a lacerated left Achilles tendon.
The Jets want to seal that one point to ensure them home ice advantage.
Connor stops, directed it behind the goal, Shifley centers, and Vilardi just couldn't pick it up. The puck moving nonetheless. Out front, Connor scores! Kyle Connor's 33rd has the Jets on the board. It's 1-0. Connor, after making a really mature decision on the entry, goes to the middle of the ice and is the benefactor of a nice little pass from Shifley. I love the decision making.
Tomas Tatar goes to the short side with a 1:22 left to go in his first period. Tuna comes calling.
He distributes and then he goes to the front of the net, and maybe a double screen with Stanley and Belmar. But Tatar with a beautiful short side wrister.
Shifley back to Morrissey, slam of the net. There's a shot. Connor scores. Connor looked off Brunauer. He has two, and the Jets have the lead again. The Jets are on the move, and it's Ehlers looking for Tyler Toffoli with a shot. Kicks in, rebound. It's in. 25th makes it 3-1.
All three lanes built. Little entry pass and why not? To shoot that, go to the net. And look at Ehlers. On the first attempt, it's not there, but he doesn't do a flyby. He stops and he waits and he just desperately leaps for this one. Nikolai Ehlers gets the third goal of this game earlier in the second period.
Sandberg, Tanev, up top it's Riker Evans. Evans with a shot, he scores! The puck has eyes! It's Yanni Gord cruising in the path of Connor Hellebuck. Evans from downtown, and Yanni Gord brings the Kraken within one. To the outside for Sean Monahan.
Beautiful pass by Bjork, trying to create that chance for Yanni.
Now a steal, Gord's on it, he'll drag it. A great play to Ty Kerchief! 1:47 left to go in the second period. Gord initiates it. Cartier finishes it, and the Kraken have tied it.
And then once he got a stick behind him, that's when Yanni put it right in the wheelhouse.
And the Jets will have the power play.
In a one-on-three situation, can't take a penalty. Though.
Smart play. New Ehlers is waiting. Ehlers back from front of the net to Fowler. Scores! There it is, a go-ahead goal from Tyler Toffoli, his 33rd. And it's 4-3 Winnipeg.
2 points Ehlers, 2 points to Foley, and the Jets have their lead back. Think like a shooter, and then now you have the option to do both. He chooses the latter, and it was the right choice. Beautiful pass from Nick.
And the Jets will have home ice advantage. The fans get to their feet. 7 in a row for Winnipeg, and they win this one 4-3.
What an outstanding season. One game remains, 51 wins. That's one shy of tying a franchise record.
There's still plenty for these Canucks to play for. Chance tonight to clinch their 11th division title and to stay alive in the chase for the Western Conference crown. Here's McCann with that back header. Stop rebound. He jams away and hawks from the goal line stand to keep the puck out. McCann wasted no time getting that one on goal on the backhand, and Markstrom had to be alert. Quinn Hughes cuts down, centers the puck, shooter, stop, and again. Keith Suter with a redirect, and then he chipped the rebound on goal, but two more saves for Jacob Markstrom.
Flames in the power play.
Here's Teddy Bluger, has a couple of shorthanded goals this year. Sends it across. Tyler Myers in. Cheers! Tyler Myers now has two shorthanded goals this year. Sixth of his career. And the Canucks take the lead over Calgary. Ilya McCabe across. Pedersen centers. And Hoglander scores. A dream season for Nils Hoglander continues. He's got goal number 24, and the Canucks are up by two.
Canucks make this look easy.
They're 2-on-1. Dakota Joshua cutting in on goal. He shoots, he scores. Goal number 18 for number 81.
Nice work by Garland to get that loose puck to speed with Joshua. He's on his forehand, so he can have a pass or shoot.
And the Canucks extend their lead to 3-0.
Now it's Mirmanov again. Puck thrown in front. Pospisil rolled by Demko to the right back. And Demko, moving to his right, made his best save of the game thus far.
Your starter back in the lineup and making a stop like that. Stretching across, eschewing the goal stick. And this went off the inside of the right pad.
Hoglander backhands the puck.
Whoa.
Calgary territory. That's a ball in the middle of things with Hoglander.
Yeah, Hoglander got his stick up, trying to protect himself. But got up high to Bahal's chin of a cross check. That's the original penalty, and we'll see what comes after this. I thought it got him in the chin, but it got him in the chest.
And that's going to do it for period number two. 3-0 lead as we get underway here in the third.
Doesn't go past as Hughes was right there. Goes off the post, was sitting there. The crowd's gasping as Kevin Rooney thought he was just going to have a tap in. Instead, Hughes started the breakout and almost pulling past Markstrom up ice.
Soucy lost his stick. He retrieves it as the pass comes across. Bahal with a shot. He scores. And the Flames are on the board.
Soucy loses his stick. He gets caught up in Postville's skate. And as he skates over, then there's an outnumbering situation at the front of the net. Bahal's got his head up. This goes right through and over the glove of Demko.
Hope check by Suter. Here's Miller. In on Markstrom. Scores. Point streaks up to 11 as JT Miller makes it 4-1. And that's going to do it. Pick up win number 50, third time in their history. They've eclipsed the 50-win mark in a season. Thatcher Demko victorious in his return to the lineup.
Second unit now for Chicago.
Brombeard moving in with a shot, and Mrazek makes the stop.
Brombeard here, you can see he uses his left hand. Shield off, Donato tries to go up top over Mrazek's left shoulder.
through center with some speed. It is Marchessault trying to dance in, and Mrazek makes another stop.
Yeah, Marchessault using his speed here. See Vlasic kind of a little bit flat-footed. Goes back and forth between Vlasic's stick. Puts that puck to an area, goes and skates to it. Gets a good shot off.
And then Slager in his 15th career game moves it along. Here is Nazar bursting in and had it poked away from behind by McNabb.
Great stick there for McNabb. Nazar definitely had a step on him. McNabb uses long reach. Doesn't take a penalty, just pokes it away. Vegas will head off to the power play.
Moving in, out in front. Dorothea found himself charging hard to the net with a chance on the power play for this second unit.
Hurdle in his fifth game with Vegas bumps it back for Theodore. Connects with Dorothea. Moves in over the line. Thought about dropping it in the high slot. Moved along for McNabb. Dorothea with a one-timer. Traffic in front. They score!
Braden McNabb crashes and scores on the
find a way to beat Mrazek, so they just piled up in front of the net, and McNabb's gonna come in and just find the garbage on this one. And look at Mrazek, he doesn't know where this puck is, Blake.
You got five people in front of the net. McNabb does a great job protecting the puck. A nice little spinorama, and it's in the net.
Nazar out high, had it blocked by Amadio. And Nazar gets through it along the wall. Now Amadio moves in. Amadio scores! On the rush! On the board, two zip nights.
Amadio does a great job winning the battle on the wall there against the young Nazar. After a shot was blocked at the point, he took a perfect shot right over Mrazek. Left side, bar down.
Looks better since coming back. Dorothea on the move with a backhander. He scores. Pavel Dorothea on the backhand. Makes it 3-0.
Puts it over the glove on Mrazek, and that definitely doesn't go in. It's off the post. The ref's trying to come back. He had a bad angle on it.
No goal. Bedard, net front, and a stop by Thompson. And then the puck ends up in the back of the net. So Chicago pokes one home with Jason Dickinson. And they're on the board with 4 minutes to go. Oh, Mrazek now has gone out to the bench. Theodore bumped it out. Moved on for Eichel. Along for Howden. Here's a shot, and they score! Nick Waugh with the empty netter to make it a two-goal lead.
And the Golden Knights jump up to third in the Pacific for now.
While we know the eight Western Conference teams that will be in the postseason, the matchups are still not set. The Golden Knights get the win over the Blackhawks and leapfrog the Idle Kings to move back into third in the Pacific. The Jets locked in home ice advantage over the Avalanche for their first-round matchup. And the Canucks clinched their first division title since 2012-13. All right, Mike, so let's talk a little Western Conference playoff picture here. The Jets, they are going into the playoffs on a roll right now. Seven straight wins for them. How important is it to have that home ice for Winnipeg?
I think it's big. You look at the fans in Winnipeg when they get the whiteout going. That place is absolutely electric. Smaller arena, you really hear that noise in there. That's such a great place to play. Plus, you don't give Colorado home ice advantage. So it works two ways for the Winnipeg Jets. Look, coming into this series, we're doing our playoff preview show on Friday. I'll be doing all the predictions then. I'm leaning heavy towards Winnipeg right now. It doesn't mean Colorado can't win. They've got Nate Dogg and all the rest of it. But
sure.
I don't love the way the Avs are playing right now. I think Alex Georgiev looks a little tired. And Winnipeg, when they get a lead and the rush defense they have, the goaltending they have, man, they make it tough. Like, you look at some of their splits this season. When they have a lead after the first period, they have the best win percentage in the league. When they score three goals or more, best win percentage in the league. They are 34-0 when they score four goals or more in a game. Can they get to three goals in these games against Colorado? Because they're kind of a, you know, decent offensive team, but they're really a great defensive team, and they have the best goalie in the NHL.
Sure, that'll be the true test, of course, and I cannot wait for that playoff preview show, by the way. Nice little teaser there. We're looking forward to that. But Vancouver, they had a big victory on Tuesday. They clinched the Pacific Division, and certainly they were happy to see Thatcher Demko return to the net. Big game for him, and it was his first one in more than a month. That's huge for them down the stretch here.
No question. The Vancouver Canucks, to me, are a different team with Thatcher Demko's in the net. They looked really good. He looked really good, which is incredibly encouraging if you're a Canucks fan. I just talked about Hellebuyck being the best goalie in the league this season. I've got Demko number two if I was doing a Vezina Trophy ballot. So the Canucks, 50 wins, I mean, they're a legit team. They're gonna be a tough out for no matter who they play and potentially into a second, third round.
Yeah, we cannot wait for it. Again, it's just right around the corner. Kels, thanks so much. We've got lots more to get to here on the Fly. Coming up, neither the Jackets nor the Hurricanes had much to play for in their finales on Tuesday, but it was a night that young Luca Delvalle-Belouz will never forget. We'll head to Columbus right after this. Welcome back to On the Fly. The Hurricanes were wrapping up their regular season in Columbus against the Jackets.
I've had a wonderful career as a broadcaster, and tonight I'm going to be a coach for some 30 or 45 seconds, and I'm going to get those guys pumped up. They're going to come away with a win, guaranteed.
Kick butt, and I want to go home a winner in my final game in that broadcast booth, and I'll see you guys after the game.
And Greaves turns them all the way, and now the Jackets march in. There's a quick shot, scores! How about that? He comes out of the penalty box, and the youngster, Luca Delvalle-Belouz, has the Jackets on the board with his first National Hockey League goal.
Officially, it's his second shift in the National Hockey League. A moment, feel like he's in a dream right now.
They're going to look at the highlight many times, I guarantee you.
As the shot finds its way, and the Columbus Blue Jackets now lead 2-0. I think they might have to give these guys a speech every night.
Now Carolina would like to cross off this 2-0 deficit as a turnover is picked up. Carolina throwing it out in front. Chance to score! Barry Kotkaniemi comes up with the marker. Now Carolina trying to work this here out in front. The score! Teuvo Teräväinen on a beautiful setup.
Teräväinen was in dial-up mode.
Carolina has picked him up. He's part of a three-goalie system there. But
rebound scores. The Jackets have regained the lead here.
Setting it up, it's Teräväinen. Snap the guy, scores! A wicked wrister from Teuvo Teräväinen. We're tied at three.
Gorecki sends it in once more. Off Spencer Martin, wraparound scores! What an effort! Johnny Gaudreau! And the Jackets have the lead again! This time 4-3.
Gorecki back out there.
What a night for Zach.
I think you requested 2-2, didn't you?
Record the most points by a defenseman in a season. 2 goals, 2 assists. Boy, I gotta visit Zach after this one and listen to this crowd here in the final set. We're gonna let him take it home. Go ahead, fans, you deserve it. And the Blue Jackets are victorious on the final night of the regular season.
And well done there on that final shift. Well, Zach Werenski recorded his third career four-point night in the Blue Jackets' win on Tuesday. And yes, he tied a franchise record in the process. Werenski finishes the season with 57 points, which is not only a new career high, but puts him in a tie with Seth Jones for the most points in a single season by a defenseman in franchise history. Well, the Sabres season is over, and now they're searching for a new head coach. We'll be back to break down the news from Buffalo when we return. Welcome back. Some news now from off the ice Tuesday. The Buffalo Sabres announced that the club has relieved Don Granato of head coaching duties. Granato spent 3 seasons as the Sabres bench boss and 3 full seasons under Granato. The Sabres went 113, 109, and 24. The team failed to qualify for the postseason in all 3 campaigns with Granato as their head coach. And the Sabres NHL record playoff drought now sits at 13 straight seasons. So certainly not the way Buffalo would have liked to see it go and have that record-long streak there, which is a drought you definitely want to end. So as this coaching search begins now, Mike, what exactly do the Sabres need behind the bench in order to improve and get themselves in the playoffs too?
They need more structure in their overall game. They were one of these really promising teams coming into the season out of the Eastern Conference, and they took a step back. And you look at their defensive stats, their defensive game, really tough time killing cycle plays in the offensive zone. They give up a lot from the house. Expected goals against are near the bottom of the league. The only reason their goals against wasn't kind of matching there is because UPL had a breakout season and was a top 10 goalie in the league this season. But, you know, we know the Buffalo's got a lot of really good young players. They've got good young prospects. They can score. I think they'll score more probably next season than they did this year. It's got Tage Thompson, Dylan Cousins locked up down the middle at just over $7 million each a season. There is a lot to work with here. And like I said, UPL having a breakout year as a top-end goaltender. For the new coach that comes in, get this team to commit to playing defensively consistently, and you probably have a team that can be bumping up on a playoff spot as early as next season.
I love it. You're right on cue, though. You got those pieces. Now it's just about finding a way to get it all to go together and bring in that structure. Thanks, Kels. Let's now take you top shelf. Here are the plays of the night.
Now the Jackets march in. There's a quick shot. Scores! How about that? He comes out of the penalty box. And the youngster, Luca Del Bell Belouz, has the Jackets on the board with his first National Hockey League goal, and it's 1-0.
And yeah, setting it up, it's Carolina. Snap the shot, he scores!
Oh, baby.
I don't think I need to add anything after Seth Jarvis's insight there. A wicked wrister from Teuvo Teravainen, and we're tied at 3.
Moore looking, waiting, wrister, deflection, score! Across, so is Couturier. It deflects in, the fires have tied it in 1. Here in the second period.
Scrambled faceoff comes back, quick shot.
Scores! David Perron! It's a tie game! David Perron has tied it up! Wow!
You, this ridiculous comebacks that's been going on.
Time for the three stars of the night. Our third star is Thatcher Demko, who made 39 saves in the Canucks 4-1 win over the Flames. It was Demko's first start since March 9th, and he earns his 35th victory of the season. Our second star is Zach Werenski, who recorded 4 points in the Blue Jackets' 6-3 win over the Canes. Werenski tied the franchise record for the most points in a season by a D-man in franchise history. And our first star is Charlie Lindgren, who made 27 saves in the Capitals' 2-1 win over the Flyers. Lindgren has now won his last 3 starts and owns a .962 save percentage in that span. And of course, his performance part of an awesome night around the National as our 16 playoff teams are officially set. We can taste the playoffs. For our entire team here at NHL Network, I'm Erica Wachter. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time right here on The Fly.
How you feeling, Hockey Town? Nervous?
On this Tuesday night with anticipation.
And it's on the line. Let's see what they can deliver.
Ovechkin on the board.
Fear no opponent in the playoffs.
That is going to draw a crowd.
What an ending to a fabulous career.
The honor is all mine.
Oh, my gosh! 3-3!
David Perron!
Caps are not out of the woods.
Fires! He scores! And Caps are going to the playoffs.
Here's a look at the top 10 plays from the past week.
Battling with Riker Evans, trailing the play. Nice little play by Carlson, who scores! Leo Carlson, what a highlight goal!
This is so tight. Awareness from Leo Carlson. It's this puck kind of bounces off the sideboards and through his own legs back to himself. And the shot is perfect.
Severson. To the circle,
gets it back, fires and scores! His second of the game, third defenseman scoring.
I love the look on Severson's face after this. And it's just too easy. That's what
the look says to me, and you see how Severson moves down to that lane, and then he looks at Johnny, just raises his stick and says, wow, thank you. Beautiful shot off of a beautiful pass here.
To McKinnon, looking.
Oh, score!
McKinnon, Arturi Lehkonen. It's the power play goal as Lehkonen gets his 15th of the year, and McKinnon's career year continues. That's assist number 84.
He'll roll into the right circle. Toberak fires. He scores! Off the left post, Connor Bedard with his 22nd goal in the season. Oh, what a shot. What a shot from the right side to go to the stick side, an area that he doesn't do a whole lot. He likes the glove side, but this was absolutely perfect.
Svechnikov with it. He'll dance around. He'll travel across. Move it. It went off the crossbar. He thinks he had a goal. I think he had a goal.
Beautiful. Lacrosse goal number three. What a play. And he's got that stick coming from Pete. Pete's ready for it. This is just marvelous quickness with his hands. Oh, and the play.
Ovechkin into space. A shot. Score!
The 30th of the season for the 18th time in Alex Ovechkin's career.
That's the thing about Alex Ovechkin. He'd be quiet all night. He just needs one opportunity. Huge goal for Ovechkin. As you said, his 30th of the year.
Nobody's done it 18 times with 30 goal seasons until Alex Ovechkin right now.
Leafs get the icebreaker here early in the second period, looking for more opportunities. Matthews with it. 64, and how many more for Austin Matthews?
And now six away. And the closer he gets, maybe the more difficult it will be for Sheldon Keefe not to play in the remaining games.
Face-off win by Larkin. Gustav Sveer moves it up and deep. Raymond puts it in front. Save! Oh, great save! Quick! Robs Dylan Larkin with a beauty.
This is a prototypical save by the guy who's going to be in the Hall of Fame. Now he's way down, and yet the glove's in the right position to make a glove save. That's a quickie save right there.
Marner, Riley, and Matthews. With Lars Eller taking the draw for Pittsburgh, it's fired back to Matthews. Scores! 65! He's match doping! And the Leafs have the lead! As many goals as Alexander Ovechkin's best ever single season.
Racing to it is Domi. Gathers up that puck, feeds it across to Matthews with a shot. Scores! Austin Matthews has 66! The most single-season goals by an active player, and Matthews continues the roll with goals in six straight.
You could feel it coming. He was getting around it, getting close, and the beat goes on. 66, four away with four games to play.